You're watching the free version of SynthEyes Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download. Hello, welcome back to SynthEyes Essentials. Up until now, we've always tracked shots with no real obstructions in them. But in real-life production, that is rarely the case. So today we will talk about how to deal with those pesky actors moving through our scene. Let's start a new project in SynthEyes. This scene was shot at 23.976 frames on a Canon R5. That is a full-frame camera, so we can set our sensor size to 36mm. In this shot, we follow my colleague René through the mystical woods of Newfoundland. The ground and the trees provide a lot of detail, so this definitely calls for automated tracking. For a moment, let's just treat this shot like we would any other, without somebody walking right through it. Let's go to the Features room and open the Advanced settings. As this is UHD material and with 270 frames also quite long, I will set my small blip size to 10, my big blip size to 20, and raise the maximum tracker count to 400. Let's blip all frames with those settings. And let's peel those. In the solver room, we can now see the green rhombuses representing the 2D trackers. As expected, they hold on pretty well to the forest surroundings. Unfortunately, they also hold on pretty well to René's rucksack and jacket. Just to prove a point, let's solve this shot. An error above 6 is not really encouraging. This solve might be salvageable, but it would take quite some time to bring this error down. The main, but not sole reason for this high error are the trackers that are locking onto René. As she is moving, they are really giving SynthEyes a hard time to come up with a viable solve. So let's rewind a bit by pressing the red cross left to the go button. It'll just delete our solve and all 3D points and put the camera back into its initial place. What we want to do is to get rid of these stray trackers before they even start messing with the solve. The 2D trackers are still in place. We could now step through the clip and delete all the trackers that stick to René over time, but there's a downside to that procedure. Firstly, it is really easy to miss any one of these guys. Secondly, René running through the image also has got an influence on the trackers around her. Take a look at this tracker here around frame 82 next to her foot. That gets picked up for just a frame by the shoe and thereby produces another frame with less than ideal data. So rather than first creating trackers all over the entire image, only to then curtail parts of them, let's make sure that SynthEyes knows from the get-go to not create any trackers in that region. In the Features room, let's click Delete Leaden to get rid of all trackers. And then let's also clear all blips. So back at square one, we can define a mask for SynthEyes so it knows which areas to exclude. For that, we will switch to the Roto masking room. I will show you two methods for creating a mask. Let's start with a more traditional one, creating a garbage mask manually. To create a mask, just select the magic wand. The next thing you want to do is to left click in the image and put down the center or pivot of your mask. So let's put that one firmly on the rucksack. And then we can left click around René to create a simple garbage mask. Don't get too detailed on this one. This is meant as a mask to keep trackers off, not feature level roto. When you're done setting down tangents for your mask, right click your mouse to close the shade. And then we can start to animate along. Grab the garbage mat by the handle called Spline 2 and move it along with René. And then adjust the individual handles accordingly. This should only take a couple of minutes. With our roto in place, let's rinse and repeat. In the Features room, our advanced panel should still have the values from before. So let's blip all frames once again. That suspiciously looks exactly as before. We can even make out quite some prominent blips on the rucksack and jacket. No worries, that is to be expected. The roto will be applied in the next step when we start to peel our blips. And indeed, we don't have any automatic trackers inside our roto. Let's take our shot to the solver room and see what we end up with. An error just above 2. So this shows us how much of an influence these few moving trackers had on our solve. And now that you know how to draw your roto manually, I will show you a so much faster and easier way to create a mask as a reward. Let's once again undo ourselves by hitting the red cross next to the green Go button. In the Features room, let's delete the Latin trackers and clear all the blips. Finally, in the Roto Masking room, delete the garbage mask by clicking the red cross here. And now let's use some machine learning magic to create our mask. Click the Mask ML button. It might take a couple of seconds, and then a dialog box will pop up. For starters, we don't need to do anything in the box itself. We just need to left-click in our image to sample the parts we want Mask ML to remove. While at first glance this looks like keying, it is not. We are supplying samples to Mask ML on what to remove. And you see that just with about 3 samples we've got a pretty good outline of Rene. We could render this right now, but I want to supply another frame of information. So shuttle along to frame 90 and sample again until you've got a similar outline to the one you created on frame 1. This one will take a little bit more sampling, but it's still pretty quick. So now you just press the 2 arrows in the dialog window and a little chime will alert you when your render is done. Let's review our Mask ML mat. We do get some accidental pickup of a tree around frame 60, but we can fix that. While we do see a red mat, we actually haven't got a reference mat created on that particular frame, so we cannot simply subtract from this. Rather, we need to just create a new sample. So like before, we can create this by left-clicking a couple of times. This should do. And then, before we render again, let's dilate the mask a bit, just to avoid any edge issues. Set the mask dilation value to around 10. This should give us enough margin around the edges. Let's render this once more and then step through the processes like we did before. In the Features room, we blip all frames and peel all. And in the Solver room, we do our initial solve. The HPix value is almost the same as with our previous method, but Mask ML can be a huge time saver. In any case, now you know both methods and can decide for yourselves how to create your garbage mats. But we still need to get this HPix value down. We already compensated for lens distortion, but we can of course run our cleanup trackers dialog. Once again, make sure to not clear the blips, this time we will need them eventually. Let's turn on the tracker radar. We can notice something very peculiar. On certain frames, quite a lot of tracker radars go off simultaneously. Take a look at frame 222. If we shuttle around this frame, we can easily identify the culprit, motion blur. There are different approaches to solve this, but as we already delved into machine learning in this class, let's take a look at another machine learning tool to help us with this issue. Once again, I will have to ask you to clear the solve, delete the Latin trackers, and clear the blips. In the drop-down menu that now says Normal Motion, I want you to select ML Motion Estimation. That way, a machine learning model will calculate motion vectors that will help SynthEyes to better predict the movement of the blips. That is why blipping all frames this time might take a little longer. Once SynthEyes has finished blipping, you can see the movement of the blips is already smoother. So let's peel all. And we do get a better initial solve. So let's run our cleanup trackers dialog on this once more. I will change the bad frames criteria from percent to HPix and set a threshold of 4. If I change my solve mode to refine, I can bring down the error to about 0.8. There are a couple of spikes in our error curve mini view. I will treat those manually in the trackers room. I will make my life a little bit easier by turning my time bar to background as tracker count. And now something is showing up pretty obviously. In the areas where our error curve is spiking, we are actually running low on trackers. So rather than cleaning up trackers or manually deleting trackers, maybe we can help SynthEyes along with some additional supervised trackers. It is pretty clear now that the moments in the shot that bring SynthEyes off course are the ones where we get these sudden few frames of motion blur. So pick features that you are confident you can follow along manually. Crossing branches like this can make it easier, or something with a noticeably different color. I would also suggest that for the moment we turn the tracker radar off. Otherwise, we could fall down into tunnel vision. What I mean by that is that we just keep looking for high peaks in our tracker radar. But remember that the tracker radar just illustrates the difference between 2D trackers and 3D points. So take a look here. Basically, all our tracker radars are peaking at the same time. That is a dead giveaway that something with our solve is wrong at that moment. So even if you would create a new tracker here, with the tracker radar being switched on now, you might be tempted to always move it where the tracker radar doesn't peak out. And that way you would just confirm the bias that SynthEyes already has. So trust your eyes on this one. Another resource we do have are our blips. Up until now, we've always converted blips to trackers automatically, defined by the parameters we set up in the advanced features window. But how about choosing our own blips? In the features room, pick the peel button and select blips that look good to you. The trails give you a great indication if a particular blip might be helpful. Once you are done, refine on that basis. In the end, it is a mixture of cleaning up trackers, manually deleting with the aid of the tracker radar, creating supervised trackers, and picking from the blips to get these spikes in our error curve mini view down. This shot offers another new challenge for us, aligning it without a ground that can be considered even. The *3 method is definitely not going to work, as we just can't be sure that the points on the ground are really on the same height. For starters, we are going to eyeball it. In the 3D room, click the hole button. Align the scene like we used to. Okay, in the quad perspective view, we can see the ground plane aligning somewhat. But if we want, for example, to cast shadows or put some CG on the ground, this one just not cut it. We are in need of some proper mesh geometry. For starters, select all the trackers that are on the ground. So don't get tempted by the top view. You will have to resort to the front and the left view. And always keep an eye on the perspective view to see if the tracker you selected is actually on the ground. With holding down shift and click dragging the left mouse button, we can continue our selection. And if you want to remove something from your selection, hold down control instead. When you're finished selecting all the trackers on the floor, use the color pot here to change their color. When we now switch over to the camera and hierarchy view, we can just shift select all the green trackers in there to have all of them selected. And then we use the little eye icon to switch them off. Now let's switch back to the quad perspective view. What we want to do now is to triangulate a mesh from all these points. So select them all and in the perspective viewer, click the mesh item here in the HUD and click convert to mesh. Little dots will appear at the bottom of each chisel. Now we can press triangulate. We have a mesh alright, but it does look a little bit skewed. One thing to keep in mind when triangulating is that the way you're viewing onto your points does have an influence on how the mesh is triangulated. So let's delete this mesh by clicking the red cross here. Then, in the perspective viewer, hold down Alt and click drag with your left mouse button to come into a bird's eye view above our drawn points. And then repeat the same process. First click Convert to Mesh and then hit Triangulate. Even from up here this looks better. If you press L in the viewer and see through the camera, the difference becomes obvious. This is just the first taste of mesh generation inside of SynthEyes. We will get more into creating proxy geometry in a later class, but with different tools on how to mask out moving objects before actually solving your shot, we once again added a couple of tricks to our SynthEyes knowledge. So let's keep this up for the next class where we will take an in-depth look at lens distortion. See you there.